So on behalf of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, and as co-chair of the program committee with Margaret McCoon, who's Judge Margaret McCoon, who's couldn't be here this evening, I'm really delighted to welcome all of you to this evening's lecture by Professor Kim Prather. And I'll give you a little history. So the American Academy was founded in 1780 by John Adams and other scholar patriots to advance the interest, honor, dignity, and happiness of a free, independent, and virtuous people. And through through its history, the Academy has convened thinkers from across all disciplines, so arts and literature and sciences, to address the biggest problems facing our nation and the world. And tonight's event is part of that history. In keeping with tradition, it's my pleasure to call to order. This is the 2,130th meeting of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. And I am supposed to pound it to order. That's what I was instructed to do. So I wanted to start by introducing Margaret Lainan and having her come up and say a few words. She is the Vice Chancellor for Marine Sciences, the Director of Scripps Institute of Oceanography, and Dean of the School of Marine Sciences. And she wanted to particularly welcome you to this beautiful place.
Thanks, Susan. This is a wonderful opportunity for us to host the American Academy of Arts and Sciences program. Thank you so much to both you and Margaret, and to welcome you to Scripps Institution of Oceanography. So the subject tonight is ocean and human health. Most people don't associate the ocean and oceanography with human health. If you Google it, ocean and human health, you get harmful algal blooms and seafood safety. But we actually do a lot more than that. A lot of that is in partnership with Skagg School for the work on discovery of small molecules made by marine organisms that have potential for drugs or for other useful compounds and resources, but also a wide variety of other things. And you're going to hear, I don't get to introduce Kim. Susan has that pleasure. But you're going to hear about an area that is really growing, and that is the impact of things that happen in the ocean through aerosols on people, and also issues associated with pollution, with nutrients and blooms associated with those, even new discoveries and new developments of new model organisms from the marine environment that are useful for human health studies. And one that's just being in its final stages of approval from the NIH is an urchin. So most people forget from back when you took basic biology that echinoderms and mammals go through a process in the very early stages of embryo development that are virtually identical. And so this is being used for neurobiology research now. So as you listen to Kim, be thinking about the close relationship between the ocean and human health and the wonderful set of examples that Kim is going to talk about today.
Thank you. So I wanted to just point out a couple of historical things also about SIO, because SIO was here, I think, in 1902 it was founded. It's the oldest. It was founded long before UCSD in 1965. And it's kind of been it developed the first, they've always been recording things like the waves, which were the optimal wave times for the invasion at Normandy. Those measurements all came from SIO. Charles Keeling was the first to measure CO2 and really systematically define climate warming. That was here. Isotope tracing, that's a long, long history of here at SIO. And now many, many programs of monitoring how the ocean interfaces with the whole planet. It's been many, many discoveries here. So, you know, I'm just really honored to introduce my close friend and colleague, Professor Kim Prather. And Kim, you know, as you can see, she's a real hands-on scientist. She's there, right there at the bench with her students and her fellows. And she's a real trailblazer in the world of environmental chemistry and atmospheric science. I think she's renowned for, especially for her groundbreaking innovation of the aerosol time-of-flight mass spectrometer, which was a revolutionary instrument that really transformed how we understand the ocean and how we understand aerosols and their effect on air quality, their effect on climate, their effect on health. So she's really been a scientific trailblazer. But I think what makes Kim more than that, she really goes beyond her remarkable scientific achievements. And she's also known for her deep passion and for her empathy. And she leads with a sense of responsibility to her students, to her colleagues, but also to her community. And she's driven not only by the pursuit of knowledge, but by the desire to make the world a healthier, more sustainable place for all. Her work has had a profound influence on science and on the local, national, and international community. Aerosols, now we all know aerosols. A lot of that comes from Kim's work during the COVID period. Everybody now knows about aerosols. But in addition, her dedication to mentoring the next generation of scientists has inspired countless students and colleagues and me. I'm totally inspired always by Kim. She's also an inspiration, as I said, to her colleagues. So, Kim, take over.
Okay, well, thank you very much for that introduction, and good evening, everybody, and thank you for being here. Can I do the gavel? I'm just kidding. I'm glad I got to do it. I can do it. Oh, I can close it. All right. Thank you. Yeah, I've never done a gavel before, I don't think. Anyway, okay. So thank you again for the invitation to come and be part of this. And it's really always inspiring, I would say, to talk about your research and tell stories. Tonight I plan on telling a few stories in front of the people that you live and work and see every day. And so a lot of my students are here and friends and colleagues, and I just can't thank everybody enough for being here. And I really look forward to telling you about the research that we've been doing. I'll talk about it, but it's been a kind of a wild ride, and some of my collaborators from San Diego State are here as well. And so I think they'll probably enjoy it, but I'm going to take you on a little bit of a tour of sort of how, it's one of those things like, how did I get here? I've asked myself that quite a bit in the last month or so. So my favorite topic is aerosols. And as Susan mentioned, people didn't really know what aerosols were. I don't know if you'd say there's a silver lining of any pandemic, but it did make people know that aerosols are more than the stuff that comes out of a spray can. I was the one that actually had the, I guess, honor of convincing Fauci that COVID is airborne. It's not droplets that fall to the ground like people thought for 100 years. But basically, this just is a map that I came to mind when the way I got heavily sucked in was I had a news person ask me, really seriously, do you think aerosols can go further than 6 feet? And this is the picture that came to mind, and I laughed, and as they say, that from that point on, I got pulled into explaining it. But basically, aerosols can travel all the way around the world. It takes about 2 weeks. They seed our clouds. They affect where and how much water falls. Classic, you know, standard sort of natural types of aerosols, the two most abundant types are dust and sea spray. And sea spray has been my favorite topic for a long time, but in CAICE, which I'll talk about, for the last 14 years. But as I say, they're amazing. We've flown through clouds to look at how aerosols seed clouds. their interactions with clouds is the largest uncertainty in all of our understanding of climate change. Which aerosols seed clouds? How effectively do they seed clouds? They can change the brightness of clouds. They can change whether the clouds rain or not, or snow or not, or how much snow falls out of them. So that was an early part of my career when I moved to Scripps. I started out at UC Riverside and I moved to Scripps. It was to work on the climate change aspects, and that's what I have been doing for quite a while. But you can see examples, they go all the way from a nanometer all the way up to, you know, 10 microns or so. We don't talk about them too much above that because those tend to settle to the ground very quickly. There's the background on aerosols. So this is the center that I started directing. It's called the Center for Chemical Innovation. It was funded by National Science Foundation and it started in 2010. And it has run for 14 years. And it's gone by incredibly fast. It's an incredible team. And up front, I have to say that, you know, I wouldn't be standing here if it wasn't an amazing team. And it really taught me the importance of interdisciplinary work. It allowed us to work with oceanographers and microbiologists and data scientists. And, you know, really, we couldn't have done it as chemists, but this was a chemistry-funded center. And so we had pressure to make sure that we always kept our sights on the chemistry part, but we were solving a big problem. And in that problem was related to aerosols and their impact on climate. And so what we proposed to do, I'd done studies for 20 years out in the field. I developed an instrument that Susan mentioned early in my career that we flew through clouds. We used all over the world, in ships and planes and everywhere you could go. But what I will say is, no matter what we did, we would do a study for 2 or 3 weeks. It costs millions of dollars, and you get some answer. You sort of take the cards that are dealt to you. 20 things changed at least at once. And I never felt completely satisfied at really understanding, in particular, what the ocean was doing to our planet. And that represents 71% of the Earth. So that's kind of an important gap. But it's really hard to study because it's vast. Where do you go? When do you choose where to go? And so what we proposed to do to the NSF was that we were going to move the entire ocean, atmosphere, biology, waves, winds, everything into the lab. And we did that here at Scripps. And Margaret was a big, big supporter in helping make that happen. And it's just been a pretty amazing ride that we've been on, and it really took advantage. I don't think it could have been done anywhere else but here. I honestly do not think that. But, you know, this is a pretty, when I look at this, this is what we told NSF we were going to do, and they believed us. And we did, and we ultimately did, and I'll show you that a little bit of that today. I couldn't leave it out, especially giving this talk here. So the center is called the Center for Aerosol Impacts on Climate, or actually Chemistry of the Environment. It started out with climate in the title, and we had to change it. And we won't go there, because you can imagine why. But basically, this is sort of the question. So what people had been doing, how do you think about the spray that comes out of the ocean? Most people would think it's just all sodium chloride. That's most of what the ocean is, right? Actually, no. I mean, it's composed of hundreds of millions of different compounds. Literally, and different phytoplankton, proteins, lipids, all signs of life. It produces over half of the air that we breathe. So it's like a forest living underwater. And so how are we going to do that in the lab? And how are we going to make sure that we study sort of the processes that take what I was most interested in? I'm an atmospheric chemist. So I was working with oceanographers to make sure that we could, you know, transfer things and get things out of the ocean just like they happen out there and make sea spray aerosols that look just like they look out there. And that had not been done before. And so, again, it was something that required people working across disciplines to make it happen. And so we did it, and this is the very first channel that we did it in. It's here at Scripps in what's called the hydraulics lab. But you can see it's a long wave channel, and basically it has seawater that gets pumped directly into it from the ocean. And in this case, I think it's about 3,600 gallons of seawater, I believe. But you can see it's not curved. This picture is curved, it's straight. But basically, what we did was we took something that people have been using to study the ocean for a long time, and we just put a lid on it. And then we cleaned all the air above that so that when things came out of the ocean, we could see them. They wouldn't react away. They wouldn't disappear. They wouldn't change to something else. So we could actually explore what comes out of the ocean, how much comes out of the ocean, how biology was a big question, what happens when you induce a phytoplankton bloom? How does that change what comes out of that ocean? So we did that, and this was a proof of concept, and that was what gave us, we had to do this in the first 3 years during sort of an exploratory phase. And then what they do is they give you 10 years of funding, 5 plus 5, but $40 million to go and actually learn some things. And so that has been, you know, it's changed my career, honestly, to lead something of this magnitude. And again, without the team, you know, I'm just very, very proud. It was just a magical team that came together to do this work. So now, that was then, this is now, and people, if people are interested, we give tours all the time. We have moved from having one channel with 3,600 gallons of seawater to a massive system called SOARS that now has winds, waves, we can control the air temperature, the water temperature, we can even make sea ice. And instead of 3,600 gallons of seawater, it has 36,000 gallons of seawater. And its newest feature is it just got upgraded so that we can get hurricane force winds in it as well. So 105 mile an hour was the number that I heard last. And so in addition, part I care about is the part in red, the atmospheric reaction chamber, so that we can take what comes out of it and put it in the chamber and actually do reactions and sort of understand this synergy between the ocean and the atmosphere. And we can do, there's light pipes that come in through the roof because it's indoors, and so we can induce blooms. As I say, we can make sea ice, we can study different, you know, different conditions, different microbes, and basically start to, we've really been going after, believe it or not, after, I don't know, 50 years, 80 years, some number of years, decades, let's say decades, people couldn't even tell you how much sea spray came out of the ocean with a breaking wave or a certain wind speed or a certain ocean temperature. But our team has done that, and it's incredibly reproducible, and it's much easier to do it here than it is in the real world, because in the real world, as that first, you know, video shows, you can't go anywhere to get away from the people, right? So no matter where you go, all your measurements are always complicated by having input or pollution from humans. And so this has been better than I would have imagined, is what I will say. But one of the parts that's relevant, most relevant to today's talk is, well, actually, let me show you the video. Sorry, this is the best part. Beatrice, thank you. She's here. This is a video made of the H-Lab going inside. The blue is SOARS. There's the breaking waves. If you look quick, you can see the lid. And the blue is where the winds blow, and we filter that. These are all of our measurements. This is my group. Actually, I think Keila is in the back. But this is basically the system. There's the waves. Look quick. There's a breaking wave. That's a viewing room where we can actually watch the waves. We can image the bubbles. We can image the waves, the foam. We can sort of basically really try to understand the physics of, and the biology of what are affecting the chemistry of what makes it into the air. All right, so this just shows a still, which is much safer. A couple of my students working. Again, you can see all of the imaging. We have acoustics inside, so we can listen to the bubbles pop. That tells us the size of the bubbles. Size bubbles are everything to spray and to aerosolization, as I will talk a lot about tonight. All right, speaking of aerosolization. So one of the best parts about it, and the thing we put a lot of time into, was actually looking at breaking waves and what gets out. And this had not really been done before, well, not with real breaking waves. And so basically, you see the wave break. And so what's happening in the white part, which is where all the bubbles are, where all the action is, are things called film drops and jet drops. And a lot of that is forming because on the surface, it's like oil and vinegar dressing. Sort of this thin film of goo sits on top, for lack of a better term. And it forms a film. And when that ruptures, that's what leads to the spray. So we spent 3 years really getting this right. And when we did, we started to see all kinds of interesting things getting out of the ocean. So this just shows bacteria actually being invaded by phage. It shows a droplet with bacterium inside. It shows these little micelle structures that had never been seen before. We didn't see them either. And no one had seen them until we actually got this aerosolization process right. So you might say, why are you so excited about aerosolization from the ocean? Well, I mean, I was interested in their ability to affect clouds and climate at one point, but I've become sort of shifted over, or I'm shifting over, we're all shifting over, to thinking about their health effects. And largely that has been inspired by living here where we are. We have a very polluted ocean, as you hear about on the news now almost every day, multiple times a day sometimes right now. And so we have a problem. In southern San Diego, Imperial Beach in the South Bay communities. And this is one of my members of my group. These are our air sampling instruments. These are at the lifeguard station in Imperial Beach. This is the Imperial Beach Pier. And so the focus of this crisis, and it's been a crisis for decades, it's affected multiple generations of families that have not been able to go to the beach. And but people have always thought about it from the standpoint of how it affects you if you go in the water, if you're a surfer or a swimmer, or you walk on the beach. And so, you know, but what about if you breathe? And nobody had really thought about that. So I should brace you for this. You may not like your Saturday morning walk on the beach as much after this talk, I apologize, but you'll know when not to do it or where not to do it, I guess. But one of the points I want to make is that the way we get exposed to water is pollution in water and pollution in food. You know, we can choose our food, we can choose our water. It's a couple of liters a day. But we inhale 11,000 liters of air each day. And so that is our number one exposure pathway, and that has been almost completely ignored, especially the connection with what comes out of polluted water like the ocean. So it's been declared many times a local state of emergency. As I'll talk about tonight, people are pushing to make it a federal state of emergency, and I'm a scientist. I've had to say I'm a scientist, but I do believe that it merits it. I don't know of another place in the United States, certainly, where there, you know, if you had a broken sewer pipe with 80 million gallons of sewage running through your streets, that they would allow that to happen and allow that to continue to happen for decades. And once we got down there and saw what we saw, which I will describe tonight, we've been heavily involved in trying to make things better. I think we're making progress. To put it together. This is the first time I've told the story. There's lots of stories, but I'm excited to tell it. But it's been, I won't say it's been easy. It certainly hasn't been easy. But I think we're now making progress quite a bit. So one of the things that's happened is, I mentioned, you know, when the water is dirty, the beach is dirty, and this is based on bacterial levels. And those beaches where the red dots are, there's a live, you can look and see if your beach is open down there or anywhere. And you can see that it's mostly down, going, walking down, you know, basically to the border. And Imperial Beach is like basically the lowest, the most southern community that has this happen. And so people have been complaining for a while about feeling not good. And I would say, I think it's fair to say for decades of not feeling well. But suddenly that has been escalating. Suddenly the reports of lung issues and heart issues and, you know, sleepiness and you can't sleep. And it's all of a sudden you started hearing a lot more stories starting this summer when we were planning to go do our study. So I'll come back to that, but I want to give you a little bit of background of where we started. We started in 2017 with Scripps oceanographers. They did this study where they were interested in, if you put dye in the ocean, it was called seaside. It was Sarah Giddings and Falk Feddersen. When you put this pollution in, they put a pink dye in the water to see if, you know, dilution is the solution to pollution or not. You know, if you do that, does the pollution, the pink dye, just go out to sea? Or does it get trapped in the surf zone? And if it does get trapped in the surf zone, how far does it go? How far up and down, how many beaches, how many people are affected by that? So we were involved in that. We actually looked for the pink dye in the air, and we detected it. And so that was our first sort of indirect indicator that certainly this stuff, if it got trapped in the surf zone, I should say, that if it got pushed out to sea, we didn't see it. But if it got trapped in the surf zone, we did. And so this shows the real pollution getting in. This shows the estuary region where we've been doing our studies. And I will say all of our studies, or most of our studies, have been done in what we call our rainy season. So it's when there is massive rain and we get these intense storms. We have been getting them. And I think it was 2023, there were 44 billion gallons of this polluted water that ran through the Tijuana River and into the ocean. That was a record. This year, it looks like we'll get to about 40 billion. Unbelievable. I will point out, during rainy season, that sounds like a lot. It is luckily diluted by precipitation. It's the rainy season, right? So, but the point is, I want to first show the results from the things that we've been doing, looking at sort of the rainy season mostly and what comes out of the ocean. So in CAICE, one of the things that we were able to do was basically think of all these things in the water and all these other things in the water and see what actually gets transferred into the air. And so this is the part that we sort of built this project on. And so, but thinking about it, that's in the lab. What happens when you go down to a region that's heavily polluted? Well, you start to see all kinds of other things that are from humans that are getting into the water, especially with flooding from storms, et cetera. And the point is, once they get in the air, they can get transferred through air patterns, miles, as I showed you, a long distance, which means the number of people that are affected goes up by a significant amount by being exposed through inhalation to these things that get out of the ocean. So one of the first studies that kind of, I think, made people start to realize, I think we have lots of hypotheses about how could this have lasted so long, and one of them is, I hate to say it, but I think a lot of people felt that they don't live there, they don't go to that beach, so they're okay, you know? But once we started showing it's in the air, and the air can go all the way to, La Jolla, then, you know, now people started paying more attention. And one of the studies we did, this is just putting out plates, and you can see massive growth, not as much at Scripps, it's definitely a fall off, because luckily air does dilute. But in Imperial Beach, you see a lot more. This is Matt, who's one of my Scripps students who graduated, but this was his paper from 2023. Where we showed that up to 76%, we used genomic tracing to show that up to 76% of the bacteria you breathe in the air in Imperial Beach can be traced back, just like contact tracing, to the Tijuana River. So this was huge, much bigger than any of us expected. And so people started talking around here, like it started to become a little more interest, a little broader interest. What about chemicals? Sewage contains all industrial waste, and sewage contains all kinds of things, and they can dump whatever they want. I should point out, the river starts on the other side of the border, and there's all kinds of factories there, and they can dump whatever they can. What things that would be illegal for us to dump here, they can dump there. So basically, what we see, this is just a paper that's under review. It should be hopefully accepted any day. But basically, what we showed was things like antibiotics, cocaine, methamphetamine, sunscreen. All of these different molecules and many more, thousands, if the ocean concentration is high along this axis, then the air concentration is high. So there's a direct correlation between polluted water and polluted air with compounds that nobody really thinks about being in the air. So this was a big finding as well. And so thinking about sort of moving forward, I want to sort of talk a little bit more about what we've been doing recently. This is Greg. Who works in the lab has been leading sort of the air efforts, Miley, and then Jake, a couple of students that have been very involved on the biological side. This is again the pier, but this shows you really well where the Tijuana River empties into the mouth of the Tijuana River, where it empties into the ocean. I won't go through all this, but on the biology side, I've become much more of a fan of biology than I ever thought I would be. You kind of realize these poor microbes, you know, they're trying to do something and then they're getting changed and they're getting, you know, I've grown empathetic for microbes, yes. Okay, so basically I'll just say that we've done a lot of work on this, and Lisa Ziegler, who's here at Scripps as well, has been incredibly essential to this. We're looking at DNA in the air, we're looking at RNA in the air. As you know from COVID, you see all this stuff, and if people are sick, it's in the sewage, it's in the wastewater. So is it going to be in the air? So people think about wastewater surveillance, they think about going to the wastewater facilities. When I hear about wastewater surveillance, I think about wastewater surveillance in the air. So did we see it? Yes, we did. So this shows what's called, and you're going to see this a few more times, so I better slow down and explain this. This is what's called the transboundary flow. This is the flow in the Tijuana River that's coming across the border. Okay, and so basically this was in, this was 2023. But one of the things we saw was that every time, each one of these spikes is a rain event. So this is the rainy season. And what you see is every time there's a spike, you start to see this red go up. That's DNA in the air. So that's hinting that DNA, most of the DNA that we're detecting in the air is coming from that river that's surging across the border. If we look at RNA in the air, it's kind of the same thing. It's sort of not as much in here, but all of a sudden out here, you really start to see the effect. And so, you know, both the DNA and the RNA in the air are amplified. And that's not a huge surprise. It may be to you, because if you thought about what is the DNA and RNA concentration in bulk seawater, it would be tiny. But what happens is the bacteria and viruses accumulate in the top sea surface microlayer. I showed those bursting bubbles. They can be enriched by a factor of up to 100,000 in the air relative to what they are in the water. So basically, you can see these are just examples of the different filters that we collect. We pull those back and do analysis. One really interesting thing we found was phage. And this is like what you see at wastewater treatment plants, not in urban air. I don't think anybody's ever detected, I know nobody's ever detected it, at least they've never published it, showing phage in air. But this, what you do is you can use electron microscopy to see if they remain intact, and indeed they do. And so we've worked really hard on being able to sample air. Air is like the hardest one to sample from a microbial perspective, because it's such a harsh process of the way you collect it and how you collect it. So we worked really hard to actually be able to keep things intact, and we're finally there. And then we finally started seeing things like this. And so phage, again, it's not something, it's one of the best indicators you have of a strong influence from wastewater. So getting back to this cumulative, sort of this flow of water coming across, I just want to make a point that one of the things that's happened each year, these are the years over here, and this is accumulation over the course of a year. And what you see is early years, you know, starting with 2021, see, 2020 kind of went up, but these are kind of low. But all of a sudden, these two, and this is carrying on out, 2023, 2024, it took off. We started getting a lot more transboundary flow. In fact, you can see this little hitch right here. That's Hurricane Hillary. And so, you know, we're basically starting to see evidence of much more of this pollution coming across, but it's also caused a lot of damage, which has made kind of, I think, part of it is that it's made the sort of the situation and the infrastructure bad all year round. I think that's part of it. So, you know, we did studies, I want to mention, we did many days in 2023, many days in 2024, all in the wet season. Over here, this guy's going to carry on out. Basically, we did what we call the dry season study. It's the first one we did, and that's the one that I want to finish up with today. Okay, so basically, this was an article. We started sampling in August. We started sampling the parts that really woke people up on September 1st. And Ben Rico's here. He was a warrior in this. And so it's just been, you know, an incredible, incredible situation. But one of the parts that has struck all of us is that it was kind of not being talked about. You kind of, like, it was a lot local. I think I was on the news. Some people said I was on the news every day. I was probably on the news every day. I don't watch myself, so I don't know. But the point is, the LA Times finally came around. It took till September 26th. And I would say even the articles that were there, even the local ones, were kind of downplaying it. Kind of like, it's been going on this long. You know, what's different? Nothing's different. You know, it was just this, it was bizarre. And I could speculate forever, but I won't. But this is Ramon, who's one of the local community members. And this is what I'm going to talk about a lot, which is this river hotspot. We went to study the ocean. We wanted to see what comes out of the ocean when we thought what would happen at this time of year, the river would not be flowing, and the water would be going out to Punta Bandera, which is about 10 kilometers below, south of the border. And it gets dumped in there, and then the southern swell brings it up. So we expected most of the pollution to be coming up from Mexico in the ocean, but that's not what we found. So just to sort of explain it, we started basically our trailer. We have a mobile trailer was set up over here. We set up air quality instruments all across this region. One way that you don't realize you have a problem is if you just don't measure it. Right? It's kind of like you don't have COVID if you don't test, right? It's the same idea. I shouldn't joke about that. But anyway, you know, this is Imperial Beach. As I say, it sort of sits on this big estuary region. This is where we started. And then Ben actually and other people in my group talked to residents who said, you know, the odor complaints were going up, skyrocketing, record levels, over 200 per day. And they said, walk over here. This is the river right here. And there's a little community here called Nestor. And so we ended up moving our trailer from here to here because, surprise of all surprises, our big question was, does poor water quality affect air quality? I never in a million years thought a river would have more of an effect than the whole ocean. Like, we had no idea, but we're flexible. And so we moved to this area, and this is how disgusting it is. You know, these are people sampling. Yes, we wear full-on suits because people almost pass out from, if you don't wear a respirator, people come by riding their horses or whatever, and they would almost, a few people almost passed out. And one time they had to call, you know, an ambulance. And it's, the air there is just burns. It burns when you breathe it if you're not properly protected. And so basically this is the pipes where we found it. It's called what we call the Saturn hotspot. And this shows it. There's so much turbulence at this spot. You can see it from space. That's a lot of turbulence. And so basically we ended up setting up right next to this site. There it is. So that's the river flowing, and it's just stagnant upstream. But it hits this spot, and you just get this massive waterfall. Of course, I get excited when I see it because I think, you know, bubbles, aerosols, right? And so, you know, look at all those aerosols. And, you know, but more than that, we found out, we had to come to appreciate gases, smells, blow your mind. I mean, they are so intense at this site. And so at this point, escalating community odor reports, we're asking, what is it? What is causing this? We came here to measure just air quality and VOCs. We didn't really come here to track down this crazy public health crisis, but when the community is hurting as bad as they were, we jumped to do what we could. And so with the team that we had, I mean, everybody was just like trying, we were all not sleeping. We were all trying to figure out how we could actually help. Words they used were like, it smells kind of like a porta potty all the time. Rotten eggs. I'm depressed. It's like messes with your mental status. It was being downplayed. So the community felt like they were being gaslit because they knew they didn't feel well, but nobody would do anything. So I don't know why, but right before the study, I asked my group to buy a hydrogen sulfide monitor. Don't ask me why. This is one of those weird ones. I don't know when it came, but anyway, so we decided to measure hydrogen sulfide right by that site in Nestor with our mobile lab. And this may not look like much to you, but this is basically, this is each night there's a spike in hydrogen sulfide. That's when people were complaining the most. People were taping their rooms, their bedrooms, their doors of their houses, their windows shut to try and keep it out because the smell was so toxic and so like noxious. It burns. And so that's the standard. And so, yeah. And so this was finally, I think, this made, as bad as this was, this made the community feel finally validated. And we were happy that we could help. We were shocked. And so a few events, did this for this talk, and it was interesting to sort of step through what happened. Because every day I would come home to my family who were here, and I would say, how was another wild day? I mean, every day was a wild day. And, you know, you were just, like, you were ducking from people trying to say, you know, it's wrong, you're wrong, you're, you know. I met Mark Edwards, who uncovered Flint, Michigan's crisis. And he's like, that's the playbook. You know, what do you think? And I'm like, he's like, welcome to the club. I'm like, I don't think I want to be in this club, you know. And so basically, you know, September 1, this is the most amazing few week period of my career. And for my young student, my students who are younger, much younger than me, I mean, you know, they got sucked in as much. I would love to tell them it's always this exciting and sucks you in, but this was wild. So September 1st, we started these H2S measurements. And September 2nd through 4th, we saw, you can see where it was. It was kind of high, hadn't got as high, but that was too high when you compare it to the standard. So I innocently, helpfully, gave a talk to the Imperial Beach Task Force, of which I'm a part. It's scientists and doctors and people from the area trying to make a difference. But we invited the San Diego County Human Health Services. And they said nothing. They just stared. And so the next day, people were writing saying, I'm kind of stunned that no one said anything. And none of us knew what to do. This is not normal. And so, okay, so the next step. The mayor of Imperial Beach, Paloma Aguirre, says, we got to get this out. If they won't, we might as well have a press conference and warn the public. And I'm dead tired. My San Diego State colleagues are dead tired. We're all dead tired. I just go, okay. They start printing our data. I mean, I'm used to publishing data before discussing it. But in this case, when there's a public health crisis, there was no other choice. And so we went to a press conference and basically alerted the community and showed our early data and said, you know, the air is toxic, which none of the community, I mean, they almost applauded if it wasn't bad news, but it was good news that they were finally being heard. Here's the shocker, which I did not know till I put this together today. September 10th. I thought this was like weeks later. The next day, they turned off the river. Paula and I were on a call with, I don't know, some congressperson or senator trying to explain that we do know what we're doing. I don't remember. It was some horrible call where we were constantly saying, no, no, this is correct. Anyway, and they said, well, the river flow just stopped. They told us the river flow can't stop. How do you stop the river, right? So we went shooting down, you know, to the river. It was still trickling. It was just not millions of gallons a day. So this was the most amazing scientific experiment of my career that they did for us. I think they were trying to trick. I've never quite put it that way, but it is true. Because what do you think happened when the river went away to the H2S? So they thought they were hiding it from us, but they kind of did the experiment. They kind of showed, you know, what is possible, right? And so, you know, basically, you know, from September 11th and on, the numbers were low. And on September 22nd, it took a while, but the beach opened for the first time in over 1,000 days. So this was the most, when I say it was a productive few weeks, this was a productive few weeks. And so one thing I'll say, just to calibrate you, just put this, you know, we're just finished writing this up. We're almost ready to submit it for publication. People really wanted our raw data. That's another story. But we said, we're scientists, we're going to publish it. And so it's taken a while, but we're close. But this just shows the river flow and the dramatic effect when it was shut down, how it tracks, how it affects the H2S. But this one is one of the best figures of my whole life. This shows a correlation between the voices, the community voices, the odor reports, and the H2S. And the R squared is 0.92. The people were the canaries in the coal mine, and no one was listening to them. And basically, they were right. We don't need our expensive instruments. If people would just listen to the community, this we wouldn't have gotten here. But at the end of the day, it was really rewarding to see it. And again, just sort of reminding you where the limits are. This is the CARB limit of 30 ppb. There's also, so it's, we're not done, I guess is the point I want to make. Not yet. But basically, this just shows a blow up of this region. These are the limits. This green line we've added is 7 ppb. That is the number that is for chronic exposure, if you're breathing that air every day. And so we're well above that. I talked to people in South Coast Air Quality Management District. At 30, they send out emails to the entire community warning them. At 70, they start evacuations of certain areas. We're like, they couldn't believe that this, and we still, sadly, don't have a plan, but we're helping, you know, our air quality measurements. I've worked with a lot of regulatory agencies. I think people just have falsely believed that San Diego air looks pretty, right? But yeah, so why? Why did it become, why, what happened? Is it just a continuation? Did it escalate a little bit? You know, what have we learned? And so this shows that cumulative river flow in what we call the rainy season. You can see it has gotten worse. But if you look at dry season, that's where you see the really big red flag. Around 2015, something funny. I have a hydrologist looking at this with me right now. He said this signature and the way it looks and the flow, and he's sort of looking at all the patterns. There's something unnatural. That's what he said. Something unnatural starts to happen around 2015. But 2023 and 2024 are incredible right here and here. This is the dry season, and we're seeing, we saw, I think it was, well, I'll show you, actually. If you look at the dry season, 2021, see the flow? No flow. This was the end of a rain event, so but when it's gone, it's gone. Then there's a little bit, again, this was a rain event, and then once it fills a reservoir, it takes a while to bleed it out to the ocean. But again, a little bit of rain, but in between, nothing. suddenly 2023, well, again, this was a rain event, so it bled out, but then it kind of stays up, and then Hurricane Hillary hits, so something's starting to maybe look a little funny, but 2024, it just, there was a little bit of rain here, it fades out, and then it just stays high. And you can see where we started squawking about the air, and there's the river turning off magically, suddenly. And so, you know, basically, there's still issues, but it's, you know, the air there. We have people from there that are here. I'm sure we'll be happy to talk with you during the reception that have, you know, helped actually supported us, let us put our instruments in their house to make measurements. And, you know, were gracious to my students, and the whole community was amazingly gracious to our group. But here's the big part. Like this now, this has always been red, and it had been green. I should say it's not green right now, because what happened was the southern swell was helping us, and the fact that the water got diverted took a while to get there. But now it is coming up from Punta Bandera, the part that we went there to look for. So just to summarize, you know, the happiest thing for all of us is that it makes us feel really good to help this community and to push things towards a solution and to help this community that has felt so ignored and dismissed for far too long. You know, our data backed it up, and, you know, they've been saying it, but, you know, thinking about poor air quality, you know, once it gets in the air, it impacts a lot more people. The river is still diverted. We'll see how that goes. Rainy season's coming, so we don't know what will happen. Nightly releases. There's some magical, again, still a little magical release that happens every night. Starts at 6 p.m. and it ends at 6 a.m. And I didn't put the picture in here, but yeah, it looks funny. There's a lot of foam at 6 a.m. is what I will say. H2S levels are lower, but remain well above acceptable standards. And the beaches, I say, were open, not anymore. So San Diego State and CDC have both launched health surveys, and the person who's running the San Diego State one is here, so I'm sure she'd be happy to talk with anybody who's interested. I can introduce you to them. Efforts are underway to get air purifiers for both particles, the aerosols, and for the gases. They're two different kinds of filters. When they originally did the filtration, they bought the wrong ones. It didn't make the community very happy. And so APCD is getting it together. Multiple requests for state of emergency have been sent to President Biden, this time with our data. So that's why we have to get this data peer-reviewed and published as soon as we can. And I think, at last count, three major lawsuits have been launched. So more results are coming. Again, San Diego State crew has done a lot of these sampling. They're going to keep going. We're all going to keep going. We're also doing more surveys. We collected dust samples in the homes and looked at you know, sort of all the air. And we've got a lot of work ahead of us. This is the tip of the iceberg, but it has made a difference, and so we're going to keep on going, and we're continuing to do measurements down there. Okay, so this work would not have happened without this person, Cindy Dankberg, and she funded, when I mentioned that we piggybacked on to the oceanography experiment, the only reason we were able to do it was because we got discretionary, her and her family supported us with a gift. So they're here tonight, and I invited them because, you know, this their mom has left a legacy. So thank you from my bottom of my heart. I mean, it's made a huge difference. I mean, look at the work that we've been able to do. And I wish, you know, she's here, but her grandkids are here and her kids are here. So thank you so much for coming tonight. And I, you know, she's left a legacy, honestly, that not many people leave. And all the residents, if they knew, and I am planning on making sure everybody does know, in the South Bay, have her to thank. We wouldn't have done this work without her, Cindy Dankberg. And so let's give a round of applause. And, you know, basically I also want to thank, because I say the family, because I met Katie back then, and yeah, it's been amazing, so thank you. I saved this for the end of the talk, because I told them I could run off the stage if I have to, so we can all run out. So, okay, but thank you again. All right, so the team that does the work, part of the team, this is just part of the team, this is just the ones that have to listen to me, and it's an amazing group, and they were voracious during the study, and again, without them, Nothing would have happened. But there's just so many people to thank. I think I could have slide after slide. We calculate there's probably 50 people that were involved at least. We do a lot of outreach with kids. you know, I've never been so involved in politics, much more than I would like. But basically, you know, there's a huge team behind this, and many of these people are here tonight. And I'm sure they'd be happy to talk to meet you as well. And again, well, I'd like to thank all of you for coming tonight, and I look forward to chatting with you when we're done. Thank you. How are we doing this? I can call? You want me to call? Okay. All right. So I see a hand, really quick hand over there. All right. Quick hand, Luke.
With the river being diverted to Mexico, mm-hmm. isn't all of this air pollution just happening there instead of in our country?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Probably. I'm trying to figure out, I'm being recorded. Let's talk afterwards. We're trying to figure out how to get the right measurement equipment over there to help them too. The air doesn't stop at the border either. You're right. And so it's sort of like one of these mini victories. You know, we got to see what's possible over here. But, you know, one of the pushbacks that's driven me a little crazy is a lot of times the excuse, I would call it, that has been used to not make it better is they said the water didn't come from here. And I'm like, well, they do hurricane cleanups and the hurricane didn't come from here either, right? And so once it's here and it's affecting your people, you need to clean it. Like, not say, oh, let them take care of it and blame the blame game, right? So there's been a lot of political back and forth. The officials were just down in Mexico City yesterday and said it's the best, you know, breakthroughs in decades. And they're working together. There's more optimism than there has been. So hopefully we can openly do measurements and work with each other. That's my hope.
I was just curious if you had any idea how these aerosols affect biological systems. And by that I mean, have you tried to like recapitulate them and put them on cell culture and see if there's a change in epigenetics? Do you have longitudinal studies of these populations? You said it's been going on for decades.
Yeah.
Can you see direct impacts?
Yeah, those are great questions. Those are next steps, I will say, right? There has to be like an epi study done, right? There has to be what we are doing, some kind of wild things, because honestly, things like nobody thought, what happens if you breathe cholera or hepatitis? Like, what happens, you know? And norovirus, supposed to be only if you drink it, but I'm pretty sure people are ingesting it, you know? And there's a lot of outbreaks in coastal communities, right? So we're scrambling right now to figure out, and I'd love to hear ideas of, you know, how to do this, you know, how to kind of get a handle on what happens when you inhale this cocktail. So one of the crazy things we're doing, we're working with one of my colleagues in pharmacy, actually Joe, and he's taking our air samples and exposing lung organoids. Let's just say they don't last very long, right? But that's kind of a reach, right? We want to get back sort of more, in some ways you want to get the mechanisms, in some way you just want to see, right? There's just so many questions because no one thought of it. So we've got a pretty steep hill to climb on the health part. One thing is good news is like, I have a call with this, I think next week. UCSD Health is gonna take a mobile clinic down there and we'll start doing swabbing and seeing like a little bit more connecting it to the human part. And then yeah, all the cell, like the other types of health studies will have to be done, no question. But I guess what the people would tell you, talk to them. And so those health surveys I've come to appreciate. We are doing them, Beatrice has been doing them. I mean, that's data, right? And so, you know, that I'm kind of like, we can't ignore that, right? And so we've kind of got that data as a starting point, at least, to know. There's been other work, but it's just been hydrogen. Like, there was this incident in Dominguez Channel, and that was 2021. And but that was just H2S. This is just so much more. So we've got a lot of work to do on that. Ian.
Where is the H2S coming from? And that it would be dumped every night. There's got to be some chemical plant or something.
Yeah, so somebody probably, I'll just pair it back, the words that are used. H2S is produced from anaerobic digestion by bacteria of organic matter. And so this river is thick. It's like a tar, like it burps. But what I can tell you is that one thing you can do in a wastewater treatment plant to remove H2S from the water is send it through a waterfall, 100%. So it's like it's locked and loaded in this water until it hits this point. But to your point, is it coming across the border? Where is it coming from? Someone's got to figure this out. And it's difficult. You know, you hear about this pump being turned on or that pump. This was magical, honestly. You know, nobody really knows how come that, because it wasn't supposed to be. So, that's got to be sorted out. Yes.
So the H2S is just the tip of the iceberg. If it wasn't for the smell, would people know what is going on?
If it wasn't for the smell?
Well, the smell alerted everybody to something bad there.
If it wasn't for the smell, would people know?
No, there's lots of other contamination going on, obviously.
It's been going on for a long time. They knew they'd been sick for a long time. I mean, they'd been complaining they were sick, okay. But then when the smells got more, mm-hmm. You know, they call this a nuisance odor. Mm-hmm. It's more than a nuisance odor. And so it is the second most toxic gas. Mm-hmm. But there's all these other, there's 1,000 other gases coming out, if that's there, right? Mm-hmm. And so people have been sick. And as I say, there's people from the community here tonight that can tell you how long they've been not feeling well. And it's been decades. Oh, we've got a student back there, Chris.
Hi.
Hi.
So my question is, how does marine layer and fog yep. affect this? Yep. And has there been an increase in complaints during fog or a decrease or... How is that looking?
That's a great question. Boy, you must work for my former community college student here with my former student, Catherine. That's a great question. So what I will say is that, you know, temperature is a big driver. That's what's trapping it. H2S is also heavier than air. So that's what traps it. They say it's like trapped 20 feet from the ground. It's just held down. So temperature drives it down. The marine boundary layer potentially drives it down. And then what about, so that's kind of the meteorological factors. The winds die at night. That's a big one. And the flow is everything. You turn off the river flow, obviously you don't see it anymore. It's the source, right? But it's also the turbulence. I think the turbulence is at that one point. There is no other place in the river you see concentrations like you do there. So to your question about fog, which is excellent, it's interesting because the residents all know us. We've helped them get air purifiers, and a lot of them are really sick. And so one of them was calling, Paul and I, complaining, was really like super sick and super scared. And the levels weren't that high, but it was during that period when we had all that fog. And so what we think was happening, but I would have loved to have measured it, but we didn't, but we will have to. Fog is like a sponge for acidic gases. And that was what he was breathing when he already had a weakened respiratory and pulmonary system. And so it's not good. And it was heavy fog, right? So it's just keeping everything in for days. And so it makes it much, much worse. That's an excellent question.
Thank you.
A simple question and then one that may not be so simple. First, how do you turn off a whole river?
You divert it.
They diverted it. Well, they made a decision to divert it.
Someone did.
Somebody did.
Someone in Mexico.
It would be nice to track mm-hmm. that down. The second question, if you hadn't had the personal witness of the residents and the emotional force that it communicated, would you eventually gotten the same conclusion from public health statistics?
That's a great question. It would have been harder because it really was the residents that led us to that spot. You know, I personally I've never in my life, and I don't think anyone, even the river guys are all super excited by this because they've always been trying to figure out why some rivers, polluted rivers, are worse than others, now that maybe they should go look for turbulent spots, right? Because they helped us find that spot. And there was no spot that ever had higher concentrations than that spot. There are other places in the river where a little bit, like it comes out, but it's not stagnant water that leads to it, which is what's written in the literature right now.
Great endorsement of local knowledge.
Yeah, a great endorsement of listening to people in the community. You know, I mean, seriously, they were the best sensors you could have, and they were dismissed, sadly. Not anymore. Yep.
One more question.
Okay.
So, hi, Kim. Great talk, as always.
Thank you.
So, you know, I'm a sampling guy.
Yep.
And I wanted to get back to the aerosols, because I'm fascinated with your telling us about the possibilities for sampling aerosols I mean, SOARS is a wonderful thing, mm-hmm. so I'm not saying, mm-hmm. but ideally we'd like to do that at
Absolutely.
Sea.
Absolutely, yep.
So what is the state of the art in autonomous underwater vehicles, surface vehicles, drones? Where is the community heading to do this stuff more or less at the sites that things are happening?
Yeah, it's a great question. I just was with somebody at Virginia Tech, and he's one of the leaders in the drone side of things. We actually use drones. We actually flew these Coriolis samplers and scooped through. Now I've learned a little bit more about their updraft and where you should actually put the samplers. I've come to appreciate that a little more. But that's where it's going, is smaller samplers, high volume, into ideal. I think, honestly, we do a lot, and there's a debate of whether you do it on a filter or you do it into liquid. I kind of like the liquid. It seems less harsh. But again, we're sort of working through that. But again, to get the map, to map it out, right? And the instruments, even for the particles, the size distributions and stuff, are getting small enough that you can fly them on drones. And we did. They brought a drone from the Red Team. I should do a shout out. They're on my thank you list. They brought a drone out and flew. They got it, and then somebody let us borrow a bigger one. And so we did drone sampling. We did a lot of mapping. That one picture I showed was from a drone. But we also, the real reason the drones came, though, was to swoop into places. There's like quicksand and bad stuff, places you don't, it's not safe for people to go. So they came in, and they're emergency responders, and they were able to get samples, that foam and other things that we would not have been able to get. So drones helped us collect stuff and bring it back for analysis. But real-time analysis, it's got to happen. Yeah, it's a great question, Joe.
Thank you.